One of the interesting things about the quiz tonight is I'm now a resident of Frederick, Maryland, which Jubel early ransomed for $200,000. The town of Frederick did not pay off that loan until 1951. No kidding. Well, I like to take on tough causes, and I've done Lew Wallace, and now I'm going to try Jubel Early. Now, popular history today has it that Jubel Early is a massive loser, mostly because we focus on the Valley campaign that he fought in the fall of 1864 against Phil Sheridan. But popular history doesn't take the timeline back. Why was Jubel Early in the Valley in the first place? Why did Lee send him there? If we look back to why Lee sent him there, we will find a far more successful general. Because what Lee sent Early to the Valley to do in June of 1864 was divert resources from Grant's army, from the Army of the Potomac. Well, Jubel Early succeeded rather spectacularly because Grant was forced to send the 6th Corps and the 19th Corps to join Hunter's army, to send two full divisions of the Army of the Potomac Cavalry to create a cavalry wing of 8,000 men, and then finally one of his favorite commanders, Phil Sheridan. So we can say that in doing that, in causing that to happen, Jubel Early succeeded spectacularly. Now, Early did not succeed at the most daring part of Lee's plan, which was nothing less than the seizure of Washington, D.C. As we'll find out tonight, it was due a lot to luck on the part of the Union and the pluck of two scratch Union forces. It was in June of 1864 that Lee decided to release one full corps of his army to join the Valley forces and fight off a problem in the Valley, and also try to divert resources from Grant and try to seize Washington, D.C. Now, this is an act, ladies and gentlemen, of immense courage, given that in June of 1864, Lee faced U.S. Grant and an army of over 100,000 men. I was listening to a history program on TV about Cold Harbor a few months ago, in which the commentator said that after Cold Harbor, Grant began his inexorable march to victory. I flew up out of my chair. My husband said, what's wrong? I said, that is one of the stupidest statements I've ever heard. Because there was nothing inexorable, as we'll hear, hopefully here tonight, about Grant's march to victory in June of 1864. Now, 1864 was an incredibly important year for the Union. Can anybody in here tell me why? Exactly. Lincoln was up for re-election. The Democrats had made it painfully clear they were going to run on a peace platform. And so Gary Gallagher calls the re-election of Abraham Lincoln the turning point of the war. So we are not even at the turning point of the war in June of 1864. Now, Lee understood what was happening. He knew what was happening in the North. He was a fairly sophisticated political observer. He had written in June of 1863 to Jefferson Davis after his great victory at Chancellorsville, but before Gettysburg, "We should neglect no honorable means of dividing and weakening our enemies and give all the encouragement we can to the rising peace party in the North." That's what this campaign is about, in part. Now, 1864 had started out as a year of great hope for the Union. U.S. Grant, the man who had seized Vicksburg, the man who had kept Chattanooga, was moving east to take command of all the Union armies, in particular, to move with the Army of the Potomac. Union morale, Northern morale, was incredibly high. Then came the Overland Campaign. Wilderness, Spotsylvania, North Anna, Cold Harbor, and 53,000 Union casualties. Union morale plummeted. The price of gold rose to new heights, and something that will sound familiar to everybody, Abraham Lincoln and Congress were bickering over the shape of a reconstruction that most people in the North thought was never going to come. But Robert E. Lee had problems himself. He was outmanned, he was outgunned, and he had a serious problem in the Shenandoah Valley. The Shenandoah Valley was incredibly important to the fortunes, military fortunes of the Union in the East. From the central part of the valley south, essentially this area was still untouched. It was still a major source of supplies for the Confederates. Southwestern Virginia, which is off this map a bit, was the source of salt, the source of lead for Lee's army. What Lincoln called the gut line of the Confederacy, the Virginia and Tennessee Railroad, ran through the valley. The Union had tried repeatedly to break that railroad. And there were important railroads that connected Stanton and the supplies in the Central Valley with Lynchburg. And Lynchburg was the key. Lynchburg was an incredibly important Confederate manufacturing center. It was a Confederate hospital center. And it was the supply depot for all that material coming in from the Shenandoah Valley. Well, Grant had sent an army of 18,000 men up the Shenandoah Valley, and the Shenandoah Valley up is south because you're going up the Shenandoah River. It's very hard. I spent a lifetime trying to do that right, I think. The army of 18,000 was commanded by Major General David Hunter. Hunter's task was to seize the Shenandoah Valley. And Hunter had managed to do it. He'd swept aside the small Confederate force in the valley, and he was moving on Lynchburg. Jefferson Davis told Lee, Lynchburg cannot fall. You must do something. Braxton Bragg, the infamous Braxton Bragg, who at this point is Jefferson Davis's military advisor, wrote Lee, if we can remove this threat from the valley, Washington will be open to all the force we can employ. Washington. So you could say, in a way, it was Braxton Bragg's idea. In a way. Lee at first didn't want to do this. This would mean taking men from an army that was already outnumbered, overwhelmingly. But then, Lee thought overnight. And he decided that prize was worth the payment. Now, why would Lee? Obviously, Lee would think, okay, I can release men, I can move an army down the valley, and that will divert resources. But why would he think there was a chance of seizing Washington, D.C., the most heavily fortified city in the world at this point? 161 forts and batteries with over 800 cannon. Because of the Overland Campaign. In order to avoid a draft and make up for his losses in the Overland Campaign, Henry Halleck, Army Chief of Staff now, and in command in the Washington, D.C. area, had stripped the defenses of Washington, D.C. and sent 48,000 men to the Army of the Potomac. Remember those heavy artillery units that took it on the chops at Cold Harbor? Those were the guys who were supposed to be operating the guns in the forts. They were trained to do that. So what is protecting Washington, D.C. in June of 1864? And of course, Lee reads Northern newspapers, so he knows this. Well, D.C. was protected by 10,000 men. Ohio 100 days men. Sorry, Mary. But not trained to operate the guns. Mary has an ancestor who was in Washington in an Ohio 100 days unit. Local militia and the veteran reserves, the walking wounded. This was not a force that was going to do a really seriously good job of protecting D.C., and Lee knew it. So Lee saw the opportunity and he seized it. He released the Second Corps, some 9,000 men, a legendary corps. We're talking the Stonewall Brigade here. We're talking Hayes, Louisiana's. And two batteries, battalions of artillery, 24 guns, and he sent them to Lynchburg, where they were to join the Valley Force. Lead the whole. He named this man. This is my next tough cause. Jubel Anderson Early. Now, what's happened with Early is that his personality, which was unique, has overwhelmed his military characteristics. Early had been with the Army of Northern Virginia from the very beginning. He had risen from regimental command to command of corps, Second Corps. He was a lieutenant general. He was, however, a man of unique personality. He was brave. He was decisive. He did not, however, look the part of a general. He had contracted rheumatism when he fought in the Seminole War, so he was stooped. He had a high, squeaky voice with a nasal twang. He was, possibly because of the pain from his rheumatism, he had what we'll call black humor and an acerbic wit, which he often practiced on other officers. He was legendarily profane. He was so profane that Robert E. Lee referred to him as my bad old man. But Lee also wrote about Early after his defeat by Sheridan, that Early had exhibited during his whole service high intelligence, sagacity, bravery, and untiring devotion to the cause. Lee was defending Jubal Early. Now, these words bound Jubal Early to Lee forever, and of course, Early became one of the foremost proponents of the lost cause. Well, Early had functioned as an independent commander in the Shenandoah Valley in the winter of 1863-1864 when he went after some Union cavalry that were trying to break the Virginia and Tennessee Railroad. He had performed well. He was known for his daring, for the fact that he would go on the offense much more than he would go on the defense. He was decisive. He had what one of his commanders called a self-reliant, self-directing strength, which is the kind of thing that an independent commander needs. None other than John Brown Gordon, who had no great fondness for Jubal Early, wrote of him that he was one of the coolest and most imperturbable of men under fire and in extremity. He had the qualities to be a good commander. Now, Early had a difficult relationship with his subordinates, including John Brown Gordon. He did not respect the Valley Cavalry, and so he would have problems with it. Now, his lack of respect for the Valley Cavalry, I might add, was echoed by none other than Robert E. Lee, who said exactly the same thing about the Valley Cavalry that Jubal Early had said. One last thing, Early expected a lot of his subordinates, as much as he expected of himself, and sometimes it was too much. Early left the lines around Richmond on June 13 and moved to Lynchburg. He arrived with his initial elements outside Lynchburg on June 17, just as David Hunter was arriving with his initial elements. There was skirmishing on the 17th, there was fighting on the 18th. Now, a member of Hunter's staff had said, "We can laugh at anything other than a corps from Lee's army." Well, those turned out to be prophetic words, obviously, because Hunter's men captured some of Early's Second Corps veterans. And when Hunter found out he was facing Second Corps veterans, he retreated. Now, Hunter was a long way from home, his home base, was up at the northern end of the Shenandoah Valley at Martinsburg. He was also low on ammunition. So it was kind of a logical thing to do. But what was totally illogical about what David Hunter did, and he would spend the rest of his life trying to explain this, was that instead of retreating down the Shenandoah Valley, he retreated into the mountains of West Virginia. His plan was to float down the Kanawha River, steam up the Ohio River, and pick up the Baltimore and Ohio Railhead at Parkersburg, West Virginia, and make it back to the northern end of the valley. The problem was Mother Nature. It was a drought year. His men ended up walking to the Ohio River. They ended up towing steamboats over the shoals in the Ohio. David Hunter would not return in any numbers to the northern end of the valley until after Jubal Early had recrossed the Potomac. So one, he's out of the game, but even worse, he didn't bother to tell anybody that he wasn't moving very fast. So Grant and Halleck will be expecting Hunter. It is one of the great breaks that Jubal Early gets in this campaign. Seeing Hunter retreating into the West Virginia mountains, not wishing to go after him, and understanding he had to move down the valley to make sure he drew Hunter after him, Jubal Early next moved down the valley. He stopped only for a half a day at Stanton. What he did in Stanton was to get rid of everything that couldn't move fast. Horses, wagons, artillery, men. He created a tight little army of 12,000 infantry, about 3,500 cavalry, 3 battalions of artillery, 36 guns. This is the 2nd Corps plus the artillery battalions from the Army of Northern Virginia plus the Valley Force that Jubal Early has. Now, while he was in Stanton, he sent a telegram to Lee, and he reiterated, "I will proceed according to your instructions to threaten Washington, and if I find a chance to take it." I want to emphasize this because Jubal Early, after the war, would say, "I never intended to take Washington." Well, you'd say that if you hadn't taken Washington, wouldn't you? But he clearly intended to take Washington, and Lee wanted him to do it. Early moved fast. By the 4th of July, 5th, he had driven all forces out of Harper's Ferry and out of Martinsburg. There was a small reserve force in Martinsburg. They had all gone up on Maryland Heights. On the 5th of July, he began crossing the Potomac River. And by July 8th, he was moving on Frederick, Maryland, where he was going to pick up the Georgetown Turnpike, the best road to Washington. The Union command response until July 5th was negligible. Halleck believed it was a cavalry raid. He believed Hunter would get back in time, and Grant believed whatever Halleck believed because Halleck was in charge up in the north, up in the Washington, D.C. area. However, on the 5th of July, Grant's now down besieging Petersburg, seized some deserters. The deserters told him, "The 2nd Corps is not with us. They're in Maryland." Well, Grant telegraphed Halleck, and he said, "I'll send a corps." And Halleck said, "No, no, I don't need it. Hunter's coming. Send me your dismounted cavalry so I can conduct reconnaissance." So Grant sent the dismounted cavalry, but he also sent the 3rd Division of the 6th Corps. Those guys were sent to Baltimore to be put on the B&O Railroad to go to Harper's Ferry to meet up with Hunter when he arrived. Now, the interesting thing about all this is, of course, Harper's Ferry is Jubal Early's territory at this point. That is how bad Union intelligence was at this point. Yay. Who's he?
Who's the author of Ben-Hur?
Yes. All right, one man believed, and that was Lew Wallace. Lew Wallace was in command of the Middle Department, headquartered in Baltimore, commanding Delaware and Maryland west to the Monocacy River. Wallace believed there was something out there, and he was concerned because he had his own spies out. And they kept saying, no, it's a Confederate army, it's not just cavalry. So what Wallace decided to do was send all the force that he could muster out to Monocacy Junction at the edge of his command. Now, at Monocacy Junction, the Baltimore and Ohio Railroad crosses the Monocacy River on a huge iron railroad bridge. What Wallace knew was that that bridge had to continue, had to be untouched if any forces were going to be sent fast to the west. So Wallace mustered up all the men he could find. And that's going to turn out to be 3,200 men, Ohio 100 Days men, and Maryland militia, and 1 6-gun battery. Wallace's intention at this point is simply to protect that railroad bridge. He had no intention of really fighting. Then on July 5th, he found out those veterans were coming. And one of the things that Lew Wallace liked was a good fight. And he thought, I'm getting veterans, I'm going to take this on. Why? Wallace knew the condition of Washington. He understood that Washington was vulnerable. He was worried that this force was going to move on Washington. He wanted to try to delay it. He also wanted to understand, what was that force? Was it cavalry? Was it a complete army? And how big was it? So Wallace began to make plans to make a stand. The troops from the 3rd Division began arriving on the 8th of July, which was just in time, because on the night of the 8th of July, Jubal Early's forces began moving in to Frederick and negotiating with the locals about that $200,000. Now, this map's a little complicated, and I'm sorry, I forgot my pointer. This is the B&O. You can see where it crosses the Monocacy River on the Iron Railroad Bridge. This is the Georgetown Turnpike running out of Frederick south to Washington, about 30 miles from Washington. Wallace performed two great services at Monocacy. The first great service was on the night of July 8th. Jubal Early's troops are moving into town. Wallace sees them turn, the outpost turn on the road to Washington. So he telegraphed Henry Halleck, and he said, a Confederate army of infantry, cavalry, and artillery in proportion is moving on the road to Washington. I will put myself in a position to defend. That woke Henry Halleck up. This was a Confederate army 30 miles from Washington, D.C. So Henry Halleck, within the hour, telegraphed U.S. Grant. He said, I must have reinforcements for this place, or it is doubtful if I can hold the city. Wallace's next great service was obviously on July 9th, when he fought Jubal Early all day. Now, Wallace had 6,500 men and 1 6-gun battery. Jubal Early had his 12,000 infantry. He had only about 1,100 cavalry, because the rest of his cavalry was out destroying the Baltimore and Ohio Railroad. And he had 36 guns. But But Wallace managed to hold all day, in part because Wallace had an excellent defensive position. He placed his forces on the south and east side of this river. On the south and east side, there are high bluffs. So he was on the bluffs. He had a river in his front. When Jubal Early came down that road, he realized he had to find a way around Wallace. That took most of the day. He got on Wallace's flank in the afternoon, but those veterans in the 3rd Division fought and fought hard. They were always very proud of the fight they made at Monocacy. And so they managed to hold for a day, but it was foregone conclusion. And at the end of the day, they literally pushed Lew Wallace off the road to Washington. Before dawn, on July 10th, Early had his army up moving down that road, down that Georgetown Turnpike. U.S. Grant had the rest of the 6th Corps marching to City Point to pick up steamboats. The race was on. All right, so did everyone in the North just ignore this? Obviously not. This is a Philadelphia newspaper. Washington, it's imminent peril. 15,000 rebels 6 miles from the city. There was considerable consternation in the North. In Washington, there was something akin to panic. Frank Wilkinson, who would fight in the D.C. militia, wrote on the 10th of July, Washington was in an uproar. We heard that Wallace's army had been annihilated. Still later, that the government's books, records, and money were being packed in boxes preparatory to its flight to New York. Indeed, Gideon Wells had kept a steamship up, steamed up at the Navy Yard to carry Abraham Lincoln and the cabinet out if Jubal Early marched into town. Early arrived outside the works at Fort Stevens, which you can see today. It's the northernmost fort in that great chain of forts. When Early arrived, had he arrived in the morning, he arrived about noon, he would have found 209 Ohio 100 Days men at Fort Stevens. But they could see the cloud of dust with the Confederates, and they began massively reinforcing Stevens. Montgomery makes quartermaster clerks. The dismounted cavalry that Grant had sent, and local militia streamed into the works. Early arrived with only his vanguard, Robert Rhodes' division. He did not have his whole army with him, and they would not be up until the end of the day because they were straggling badly. These are guys who have walked from Lynchburg, Virginia, in temperatures over 90 degrees and have fought a battle. They're simply tired out. Jubal Early, Gordon, they all rode up and down the ranks trying to get them to move faster, but they could move only so fast. Now Early nevertheless deployed Rhodes' division and sent them out against Stevens. They got within 50 yards of Fort Stevens. The guys actually wrote that the guns were being fired, but they thought the gunners were firing at the moon and stars. It is very possible that Montgomery Blair's house was set on fire by Union artillery, not by the Confederates. So, what happened? Well, out of the fort came that dismounted cavalry. Out of the fort came those Ohio 100 Days men, that militia, and they managed to push Rhodes back and hold for the rest of the day. Now, Early's army was up that evening, but the 6th Corps began arriving at the docks of Washington that afternoon. They were marched through town, and by the night of July 11th, they were in the works at Stevens. So Early got up on the morning of July 12th, did a reconnaissance, and saw the veterans. Now, he did not retreat. There was fighting that day. That's when Abraham Lincoln was fired on. But he knew the jig was up. And he retreated back into Virginia on the night of July 12th, arriving in Virginia on July 14th. He told his generals, well, we may not have taken Washington, but we sure scared Abe Lincoln like hell. It's a very Jubel early thing to say. It was a very, very close thing, though. But for monocacy, but for that plucky little horse at Fort Stevens, Jubal Early might have marched into Washington. He had no intention of holding it, simply marching in, burning some buildings, taking all the money he could take, generally wreaking havoc, and leaving town. Okay, were there repercussions? You better believe it. People were furious. Okay, we've been through the Overland Campaign. 53,000 casualties. Oh, Lee's trapped around Richmond. Not. Lee's threatening Washington, D.C. The Assistant Secretary of War, Charles Dana, wrote Grant that he would be held responsible for this whole disgraceful affair. He said that the black and revolting dishonor of this siege of Washington would very likely lead to the defeat of Mr. Lincoln and the election of General McClellan to the presidency. One newspaper in New York editorialized, if the president cannot discover and correct the sources of these blunders, the people in the approaching election will not be slow to discover one method by which they can put an end to this reign of military incompetence in Washington. And as all of you know, July and August were a low point for Lincoln. Okay, Jubal Early stayed in the valley. He was expected to go back. In fact, the commander of the Sixth Corps, who followed Early essentially across into Virginia to the Shenandoah River, thought that Early was returning home. Early retreated after the Battle of Cool Springs, or Snicker's Ferry, which Early won. Early decided he needed to move further into the valley because Hunter was coming in from the north. He had the Sixth Corps coming in from the east, and he needed to go to a better place, so he moved down the valley a little bit. Well, the commander of the Sixth Corps talked to Grant, and Grant said, come on back. He's heading to Richmond. Early had that job, divert resources. So Early stayed. And on the 24th of July, he attacked the bulk of Hunter's infantry in the Battle of Second Kernstown. Hunter's infantry at this point is commanded by none other than George Crook, a famous Indian fighter, later to be a famous Indian fighter. Early drove, routed Crook. Hunter and Crook moved back across the Potomac River, and the Shenandoah Valley belonged to Jubal Early. Now, while David Hunter had been in briefly at the northern end of the Shenandoah Valley, he had burned the houses of several prominent secessionists, including, I might add, the house of his own first cousin, who had been named for his father. David Hunter was a hard man. Jubal Early was angry. He decided that the North needed to be taught a lesson. And so, he sent John McCausland with his own cavalry and Bradley Johnson's cavalry to the town of Chambersburg, Pennsylvania. They were to demand either $100,000 in gold or $500,000 in U.S. currency, or the town would be burned. Well, the good burghers of Chambersburg believed Union cavalry was going to show up. They proved to be disastrously wrong. John McCausland burned the town to the tune of $6 million in reparations that the state of Pennsylvania ultimately paid the people of the town. This was the last straw for Grant, actually. Grant was told in no uncertain terms by Lincoln, you've got to do something about this guy. So, as I said earlier, the 19th Corps, the 6th Corps, plus Hunter's army, an army of 35,000 infantry, two divisions of cavalry to make a cavalry wing of 8,000, and
his best commander. That's what Grant put together to take care of Jubal Early. Now, of course, since Jubal Early still had
that 12,000 infantry and the 3,500 cavalry, this was a foregone conclusion, ladies and gentlemen. 3rd Winchester, Fisher's Hill, Cedar Creek. It was a foregone conclusion. Sheridan was told at a house that is on the battlefield of Monocacy, follow him to the death. He was told that by Grant. He had also been told by the Secretary of War slightly before that, but do not lose a battle within the vicinity of Washington, D.C., or we may not be reelected, which is one of the reasons I think that Sheridan held back for so long. So, I hope I've convinced you all that Jubal Early is not the terrible general that everyone thinks he is. He was massively outnumbered in the valley. He had no chance. But what he had done was divert resources. The problem was that Robert E. Lee could not take advantage of that diversion of resources. What Jubal Early had not done was seize Washington. And that, as I said in the beginning, was due to luck and the pluck of two scratch Union forces. Thank you all very, very much.
If anybody has questions about Lew Wallace, I'll also be happy to answer them.
Yes, Bruce.
Did Jubal Early dye his hair?
No.
It was so dark.
No, not that I know of. As a matter of fact, one of the other things that's not in that picture, his beard, he chewed tobacco. And apparently his beard was always stained with tobacco. He's a great guy. Not the kind of guy that women would love.
Well, actually,
he may have liked them too much. He had two families. He never married. He apparently had two families, one by a white woman and one by a black woman. Interesting guy, I think. Sir.
I'm particularly interested in economic issues. I'm familiar with the Federal Reparations Commissions that went on for a very long time. Mm-hmm. Your remark about Chambersburg is the first reference I've heard to a state government doing that.
Yeah.
Could you say more about that?
The state of Pennsylvania decided right immediately after the war to repay the citizens of Chambersburg.
And that was the only...
That I know of, that was the only reparation paid by state. Certainly, the citizens of Frederick first went to the state of Maryland and asked for reparations for the $200,000 that the ransom they paid, but the state refused. And then, I don't know if anybody, if you're a Marylander, you've heard of a Senator Mac Mathias. He's a longtime senator from Maryland. And every year, during his term of 20 years, which ended, I believe, in the 70s, he would put in a bill to Congress to get Congress to pay back that $200,000 to the citizens of Frederick. Never did it. Oh, okay.
I was saying that he asked about the reparations that Pennsylvania paid, and whether Pennsylvania, it was unusual for a state to pay reparations. Well, Pennsylvania, to my knowledge, only paid reparations for Chambersburg. The citizens of Frederick, who had to pay that $200,000 ransom, went to the state of Maryland, which refused to pay the ransom back. But Mac Mathias, who was longtime senator, 20 plus years from Maryland in the 50s, 60s, and early 70s, repeatedly put a bill into Congress every year asking for Congress to pay that $200,000. Never went anywhere.
Wasn't also an objective of Early to free the community?
her in Maryland?
Yes, absolutely. I don't have time to talk about that too much. Was not one of Early's objectives to free the Confederate prisoners at Point Lookout in Maryland. Absolutely. It was a plan hatched by Jefferson Davis and a gentleman named Robert Taylor Wood, who was the only Confederate that I know of to hold commissions in the Confederate Army and the Confederate Navy. He was a close friend of Jefferson Davis's. He came up with a plan whereby a force would move on Point Lookout, a cavalry force, from Point Lookout is at the extreme southern end of Maryland, Chesapeake Bay part of Maryland, the western shore of Maryland. And a cavalry force would move in from the north, a Confederate cavalry force, and a force of Confederate Marines would land at Point Lookout, and this joint operation would take over the prisoner of war camp, free the Confederate prisoners, and then those that could walk would join Jubal Early's army. Now what happened was that this great plan was published in the Richmond newspapers. So the Union began moving the prisoners out of Point Lookout, and Jefferson Davis called the Confederate naval part of the operation off. But by that time, Jubal Early had released Bradley Johnson. Jubal Early was way too far away to notify, so Bradley Johnson moved on what he called an impossible mission through Maryland to cut the railroads to the north, the Pennsylvania Railroad, and then down to free the prisoners at Point Lookout. But Jubal Early, Bradley Johnson found out there was a large Union force, the 6th Corps, coming, and Jubal Early recalled him, which was good. There wouldn't have been very many prisoners there anyway, and there wouldn't have been any Marines, so. Whoa. Yes. 1, 2, 3. Yes.
Ma'am? Was the president of the B&O Railroad working closely with Wallace or with the, on his own out of concern for what was going on?
Yes.
Was the president of the B&O Railroad working closely with Wallace out of concern for what was going on? Absolutely. John W. Garrett, who had started out the war, interestingly, as a Southern sympathizer, president of the Baltimore and Ohio Railroad, was by this time massively invested in the Union. He was worried about his railroad, and his agents in the Shenandoah Valley were the first to pick up word of the Confederate force moving in the valley. And so Garrett both kept telling Stanton and Halleck, no, 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 this is a serious thing, but they managed to ignore him. And Garrett also went to Lew Wallace and said, I think this is a serious thing, and you need to protect that Iron Railroad Bridge. So Garrett had a very intimate part in this whole campaign. And there were two more questions back here?
Yes. Briefly, where was Lew Wallace on the first day of Shiloh?
Oh, God, I can't do this briefly. Briefly, where was Lew Wallace on the first day of Shiloh? Following U.S. Grant's orders. The problem was the roads. Wallace didn't tell Grant the road he was going to use to get to Shiloh. Grant and his staff knew nothing about the roads between Crump's Landing and Pittsburgh Landing. Grant's order to Wallace, Grant's movement order, was verbal. Grant did not write it. We have conflicting evidence on who actually wrote the thing. So Wallace said he got an order to move to the right of the Union Army, which would have been the road Wallace was on. That was the closest road to the right of the Union Army. Grant said, I always wanted him to move to Pittsburgh Landing. But when Grant finally, near the end of his life, understood what road Wallace was using, he actually, and you can find it at the end of the chapter on Shiloh, he wrote a note that exonerates Wallace, in which he says, my order was verbal, and to a staffer who was to carry it to General Wallace, so that I am not competent to say just what order the general received. So Wallace was doing what he thought he ought to do. Grant was thought he wanted him to do something else. Now, one last thing, I could go on all night about this, but one last thing, that walk everyone was talking about. Wallace got his order to move at noon. He moved at noon. He got to the battlefield with his division about 7 o'clock. In October 2005, for the first time since 1862, literally, because we marched through canebrakes and we followed the exact route. It was 16.75 miles. It took us 7 hours and 15 minutes. Wallace wasn't slow. It was the fact that he got the order late. It was the fact that the roads were confused. So, but I could go on all night. If I'd be happy to talk to you more about it afterwards.
Gail said something too about the two roads. And Grant assumed that you had worked on the River Road and you had not.
Well, Grant said that later. Grant assumed he had worked on the River Road because the bridge across Snake Creek on the River Road is called Wallace's Bridge. Interestingly, Wallace's Bridge is named for the man who owned the land it was on, a man named Wallace. The people who actually worked on the bridge were supervised by Grant's engineer, none other than James Birdseye McPherson, were men from W.H.L. Wallace's division. It's really not, it's a much later in the game confusion, and it's confused enough. It took me years to finally come up with what I think is a solid theory about what happened. And there was one more question back here. Sir?
You talked about Burley's peers and his subordinates and what they thought. What did his soldiers think?
I forgot to read that. Thank you. What did Early's soldiers think of him? Well, because he was he wasn't an admirable figure because he was stooped. His soldiers respected him. They were not fond of him. They called him Old Jube. They also called him Old Lop-Ears when he wasn't around. And one, this is wonderful, thank you. This is the best backhanded compliment I've ever read. One of his soldiers wrote home that Early was as brave as he is homely, and as homely a man as any man you ever saw.
That's awesome.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Donation on your behalf for your wonderful talk today. And oddly enough, it's to the New Wallace Study Preservation Society.
Thank you very much.
One announcement I'm sorry, I skipped down at the guest announcements. I apologize for that. There is one more piece of business before we conclude here. I did get an email from the editor of North and South Magazine. They are making available to all Chicago Civil Roundtable members.